Happy Thursday, my friends. Welcome on into NHL Puck Line, presented by our friends at FanDuel Sportsbook. I'm Laura Jabara. That's Todd Furman. And we got all of the latest and greatest hockey news coming at you. Todd, happy Thursday. How are you doing today? Having a good day?
Yeah, I'm doing well, Lauren, but you know what? This is the time of year sometimes you're getting a little bit of sports overload. I mean, we talked about college basketball. We know the NHL playoff races are heating up, and I can't hide some of my excitement for Major League Baseball's opening day. So it's balancing the NHL that obviously gets top billing, but I'm curious to see how my Yankees will do against the Giants early afternoon.
I know, it's going to be exciting. Opening day, you can smell it in the air. I'm in New York right now, and I've heard a lot of Mets fans, too, around these parts talking about their Mets team this year. So looking forward to seeing how everything plays out in the MLB. We got college basketball this weekend, semifinals, and the finals of March Madness. NBA season wrapping up, NHL season, the postseason right around the corner. So we're going to bring you all of the latest news because there's 11 games on the slate tonight. We're going to get into four of them, talking about the best betting angles and so much more. So let's start it out. The New York Rangers taking on the New Jersey Devils. We've had some really great matchups between these two teams at this point, and this could be a postseason matchup, probably. The Rangers nipping at the heels of the Devils for home ice advantage in the first round. The Rangers right now on a three-game winning streak, sitting only 2 points behind the Devils. They're 9-1-1 in their last 11 games as they're trying to surge into that postseason. We've seen Igor Shesterkin really step up his play too. What have you been liking from the New York Rangers team right now? Because they're on a different trajectory than the New Jersey Devils are at this point.
Well, Lauren, I mean, I'm glad you're in New York because clearly it's for the game of the night for the Battle of the Hudson between the Rangers and Devils. So I expect you to see you at the Rock for this game. And you mentioned two teams that appear to be trending in slightly different directions. The Rangers white hot right now. You talked about that 9-1-1 record. And it doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out why the Rangers are playing better hockey, because the underlying metrics aren't improving. Yes, they're getting some production from some of those trade deadline acquisitions, but it's all Igor all the time. And as Igor goes, so do the New York Rangers. And that's part of the reason this team has been so prolific of late. Over those last 11 games that you mentioned, even when he's not out there, I mean, this team is holding their opponents at bay. But in my opinion, it's a bit of a step up in class today. And we've seen Igor struggle historically against the Devils. It leads you to believe that maybe New Jersey is the team that provides a little bit of kryptonite here, knowing that we'll get some foreshadowing for a playoff series where home ice is still hanging in the balance. Should be fascinating to watch. If a Devils offense that's been locked in a little bit of a slump over the last 5 to 7 games can get on track against one of the league's best netminders.
The Devils offensively, they are still a top five team. They're averaging 3.45 goals per game. But you look at their last 8 games, they've only won 2. Yes, they're going to the postseason for the first time since the 2017-2018 season. This is the wrong time, though, for them to be in a slump, especially going up against a goaltender like Igor Shesterkin. But guess what? On the other side, Vitek Vanacek, he's lost his last 3. He's still been really solid between the pipes for them. He's only allowed 2 or less in 3 of his last 4 starts. He has a 2.50 goals against average, 909 save percentage on the season. You talk about how good Igor has been. What have you seen from Vitek Vanacek? Although he's not necessarily getting those wins in his last few starts, it feels like he's still been playing solid. Could he help this New Jersey Devils team get back on track?
He's been good, but he hasn't been great. And that's always a red flag for a young team that's going to need one of these goalies, whether it's Vitek Vanacek or Mackenzie Blackwood, to raise their level of play. If the Devils, who are probably a year or two ahead of schedule, are able to make any sort of inroads as far as the postseason is concerned. But the nice part for Devils fans, even while they've been mired in a little bit of a troublesome run, from an expected goal share standpoint at 56% over the last 10 games in all situations, still the 5th best mark in the league. And the Devils have been great when you look under the hood at how they've performed from an underlying metric standpoint all season long. And during that same span, they're still creating plenty of chances. 5th in the league over the last 10 games in expected goals at 3.66. And I think that's so important for a young team to know that chances are coming, inevitably the goals will as well. And as we saw from that graphic earlier, they've had Igor's number. So I think New Jersey fans, they can pump the brakes. There's no reason to press the panic button just yet. The one thing, though, that I would like to see from the Devils, and it probably needs to start tonight with the Rangers in town, is getting off to faster starts. I mean, Ryan Graves, in an interview earlier this week with Amanda Stein, the Devils beat reporter, pretty much said, hey, look, we're a young team. Sometimes we don't come out of the gates flying. But when you step up in class and the games start to mean more like tonight's game does, you have to be right there engaged from the opening puck drop, because you can't lean on Vitek Vanacek to try and keep you in contest or to potentially steal points against a Rangers team that's surging right now.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see how this game plays out. Both teams, though, top five, top seven defensively. Do you feel like this is going to be a game where goals are at a premium? Because right now the total is set at 6.5. But also the New Jersey Devils are decent favorites in this game, despite their slump and despite the way that New York's been playing. Like, how do you read the line for this one, too?
You know, it's so difficult because I actually make the Devils a slightly bigger favorite in this matchup. You can see there at minus 137. My numbers for the Devils are closer to minus 145. So it's not a massive edge by any stretch. But of course, you have to adjust for goaltender's current form. And right now, there's no comparison between the way Igor has looked against Vitek Vanacek. So for me, lean ever so slightly towards the Devils. I think, honestly, it's a more important game for them, given their run of poor play. And when you're looking at that race throughout the Metropolitan Division tightening up, I think the Devils would be a huge beneficiary of home ice. Although, let's not kid ourselves, in a best of seven against the Rangers, I have to imagine there'll be a lot of blue shirts in the stands, regardless of the venue they're playing in over the course of that first round matchup.
Speaking of shirts, Matt Selly said, I like Todd's t-shirt in our chat today. So you get a little shout out on your t-shirt that you're wearing right now. We also have a question from Ray J. Who is the better goalie in New York? Look at that. Winnipeg Jets, baby. Let's go.
The better goalie in New York for me right now in current form, I'll say Ilya Sorokin 1A, Igor Shesterkin 1B, and then we take a step down in terms of the way we're seeing goaltending struggles from the Devils. I mean, Sorokin has been the better goalie for a full season body of work, but don't sleep on the way Igor is trending right now. And we talked about that at great lengths, Lauren, since this show started in early February, that they said behind the scenes in New York that the work Igor was putting in, eventually the results were going to come. And if you're a Rangers fan, you couldn't be more thrilled knowing this team's playoff projections never really hung in the balance. And at the same time, you're getting Igor trending up where the games start to mean a heck of a lot more than they do in January, February, and early March.
Yeah, if you look at the Devils, they are 8-1 in their last nine games against the division. So something to keep in mind. Possibly that's why they're a favorite. More games going on. Let's talk about the Nashville Predators taking on the Pittsburgh Penguins. Both teams battling for a wild card spot right now. The Preds coming off of probably their best win of the season, beating the Boston Bruins at home, which is a rarity for the Bruins this season to lose at home. But they are still 3-4-1 in their last eight games after selling at the deadline. They're 3 points back from the Jets right now, who have the second wild card spot in the West. How comfortable do you feel with the Nashville Predators at this point? Because people thought after they sold basically everyone at the trade deadline that there wasn't even a chance this team was going to be completely rebuilding. They're still kind of in the mix right now. Do you think that they have, you know, so you're saying there's a chance. Do you think that they still have an opportunity to possibly make a postseason push?
You know, it's pretty incredible. And John Hines and the guys that were left behind in Music City deserve a world of credit for how they've used all those deals at the deadline as a rallying cry to continue to fight for that last playoff spot in the Western Conference. And they're doing it right now without Roman Josi, who's listed as a game time decision tonight. But Lauren, when you go through this roster for what Nashville has accomplished this season, I mean, Roman Josi still on the team, game time decision. Matt Duchene out. Philip Forsberg out. Mikael Granlund traded. Mm-hmm. He'll be on the Pittsburgh Penguins tonight when they see their former teammate and Nino Niederreiter. I mean, Tommy Novak is the player leading this team right now in their active roster, and he has a grand total of 14 goals. The results are coming for the Preds, and quite frankly, I'm not sure how they're doing it, because if you look at some of their offensive numbers, from an expected goal standpoint, they're 32nd in the league over their last 10 games. And you look at some of those February and March comparison, no red flags in terms of shots on goal, but obviously the quality has subsided a ton. And when we talk about Nashville and their playoff prospects, we use the term goalied all the time, where a goalie stands on his head. They're going to have to coin a completely separate term in Nashville, and it's all about getting juiced. I mean, when UC Saros plays well, they can beat teams like the Bruins. When UC Saros looks human, gives up seven goals in a 7-2 thumping at the hand of the Seattle Kraken. So I'm not necessarily going to advocate for them being a live underdog here, but the Pittsburgh Penguins on the other side haven't exactly been the model of consistency themselves.
Absolutely. The Pens right now are looking for a sweep of Nashville. They're clinging like as tight as they can to that second wild card spot in the East right now. They're 3 points ahead of the Florida Panthers at this point, but they are slumping a little bit. Like you said, they're 4-6-0 in their last 10 games. They're coming off of a loss to the Red Wings. And a lot of it's been one, because of injuries, and two, it's been because of inconsistent play. That's why we've seen Tristan Jarry maybe not have his best season. It's actually probably one of his worst seasons since he's been in Pittsburgh. He's 21-10-6 on the year, just under a 3 goals against average, .908 save percentage. But you mentioned UC Saros as well. Like, both of these teams have so much to play for at this point, but Saros is still 3-1-1 in his last 5 games. He allowed 15 goals, 7 of them to the Seattle Kraken, like you said, but only 1 to the Bruins. So who has the edge between the pipes for a battle like tonight?
Yeah, I mean, look, UC Saros gets an edge against almost every goalie in the NHL. The problem is his supporting cast can't mask some of the deficiencies. So the margin for error for UC Saros when he starts, significantly different than the Pittsburgh Penguins tandem. And all signs point to Tristan Jarry getting the nod tonight. But you mentioned his inconsistency. And I think Jarry is fighting through a variety of nagging injuries. I mean, we can look at the numbers right now with a goals against average over 4, a save percentage of .861 during the month of March. And he doesn't look anything like the goaltender we saw for stretches earlier in the year when he was healthy. And it doesn't all fall on him. I mean, this is a Pittsburgh Penguins decor that's extremely banged up. I mean, if you had a chance to talk to Coach Sullivan, I don't think he anticipated that his third defensive pairing was going to be Mark Friedman and Chad Ruedel down the stretch while Pittsburgh fought tooth and nail for every point. I mean, you have guys like Dmitry Kulikov, Jan Ruda, and of course, Marcus Pettersson that are all sitting on IR. If the Penguins can limp their way into a playoff bid and get some of those defensive reinforcements there, we know about the scoring prowess they have up front, and they're getting a ton of productivity from their top two lines. I mean, right now, Brian Rust is the only player in that top six that may not be performing at a high level, but he's still generating chances. I mean, I know it's just 1 goal and 3 assists, but he does have 30 shots over the last 10 games. You look at Jason Zucker, Evgeny Malkin's playmaking ability, and Rickard Rakell. I mean, these two top lines are as scary as just about anybody going in the Eastern Conference. The problem for the Penguins is they can't rely on reliable scoring coming from that third and fourth line. And when goaltending is a question mark and you're a little bit thin on the blue line, it doesn't necessarily leave you brimming with confidence, especially when you're priced at north of $2 today against the Predators.
Yeah, I think the Pens having home ice advantage definitely helps them a little bit. And Sidney Crosby aging like a fine wine, that always helps too, 31 goals on the season. But this is going to be an interesting game to see how it plays out. One fam question, Steve Roberts. What's up, Steve? Will Pittsburgh's playoff streak end this season? I don't think it will. I think that they have a lot to play for at this point. And at this point, they have the upper hand since they are sitting in that second wild card spot. But I want to get your opinion. Do you think that their playoff streak continues this year? They make it for the 17th straight season?
I do. I'm right there with you. And I think when you look at the way essentially it's become a 3-horse race for 2 spots.
Yeah.
And the New York Islanders, you know, had to go to a shootout last night to get 2 precious points against the Capitals. You look at the Florida Panthers, they snatch victory from the jaws of defeat, getting that late goal 6-on-5 against the Leafs before they got the game winner in overtime. But this is a Panthers team who is going to play their second game on a back-to-back. It is so important for Pittsburgh to do everything they can to put pressure on Florida, knowing that we talk about inconsistent goaltending. I mean, Sergei Bobrovsky is right in the crosshairs for that as well. I think the Penguins find a way just because they have that veteran presence and the star power. And while we don't talk about Sidney Crosby putting the team on his back the same way Connor McDavid has done in the past, Sid has definitely raised his level of play. And I think 87 makes the difference. So Pittsburgh's longstanding streak of postseason appearances stays intact by the slimmest of margins.
Yeah, Sidney Crosby still looks like he's like 22 years old, and he's playing at peak form, which is wild with his age. Aging like a fine wine, as I like to say. Let's head on out to Chicago. The Windy City St. Louis Blues are in town. Why not talk about this game? The Blackhawks sit at 8th place in the Central right now. The Blues are sitting at 6th, and the Blues have been pretty blue recently. They haven't been playing their best hockey this entire season, but neither have the Blackhawks, and especially with no Patrick Kane now in the lineup for them. But the Blues, they figured it out a little bit, at least recently. 7-3-1 in their last 11 games. Jacob Brana has been really, really good, leading the team 3 goals and an assist in his last 3 games. He's had 8 total goals in the last 11. Are we seeing a little bit of resurgence right now, Todd, from the St. Louis Blues? So they have more momentum heading into next season, feeling like they're ending the season on a little bit of a high?
Well, it's so funny because we just talked about the Eastern Conference playoff picture and, you know, who we thought was going to get the eighth spot in the East, Pittsburgh doing everything they can. Having grown up in Chicago, a lot of my friends are Blackhawk fans, and all I do is get texts, man, I hope we lose by 5 goals tonight. I hope we lose by 6 goals. We want to do everything we can to try and get that number one overall pick and get that transcendent talent in Connor Bedard in here to kind of take on the same mold as Patrick Kane. Unfortunately for Blackhawks fans, their schedule tonight is semi-favorable, but down the stretch, I mean, there's a real chance that the Blackhawks could be staring down the barrel of a minimum of points. Yeah. You mentioned the Blues resurgence, and things will be a little bit more difficult tonight. They're going to play without two of their top three scorers, Pavel Buchnevich and Robert Thomas, both out with upper body injuries. And that may be more precautionary, knowing that the Blues are on the outside of the playoff picture with no path to relevance in that regard. But you showed that graphic, Lauren, and I think it's important when you look at the Blues, and I throw about around a lot of advanced analytics in my handicapping. So when I use the term expected goals, that's what suggested the offensive output should be on the quality of scoring chances, where those scoring chances are coming from over countless sample sizes. And right now the Blues, despite scoring actual goals, have been one of the league's biggest outliers in that department. I mean, they have 32 goals over that 7-game stretch. But if you look at some of the underlying metrics, suggests the Blues should have a grand total of 15 goals. So they're outrunning some of those numbers. And you do wonder where regression could come in. As someone who was sitting on a Vancouver Canucks ticket the other night, watched that game and was a little bit surprised that it was the Blues able to pot 6 goals and get the big win. So it's buyer beware here. And I think when I look at this Blues team, not one that I'm very comfortable with laying prices on the road, even against a Blackhawks team that struggled a ton of late and failed to be competitive, losing all of their last 6 games by 2 goals or more.
Yeah, the Blackhawks you mentioned, they're in full rebuild mode at this point. 2-7-1 in their last 10 games. We have a goaltending battle tonight between Jordan Binnington, who really has not been very good this season. Peter Mrazek most likely to start, unless you have other news on that. But Peter Mrazek right now has a 3.61 goals against average, .896 save percentage. I feel like even though both teams aren't necessarily like the best offensive teams with the goaltending, we could see quite a few goals being scored tonight. How do you feel about the battle in between the pipes? And do you feel like maybe we could be seeing a lot of pucks hit in the back of the net?
Well, one thing I'll tell you down the stretch, I will not be betting any St. Louis Blues games under the total. Like, that's completely off the table. It's over or past for a lot of the reasons that you outlined. And when you're looking at Jordan Binnington's numbers, talk about a rough month of March. Goals against average, 4.16, a save percentage of .868. And in the last 7 starts that Binnington has made, he's given up 30 goals. Now, the perfect cure-all for a goaltender that's struggling, though, is this Chicago Blackhawks offense that lacks a ton of firepower. So that is a little bit of cause for concern. But if they're going to break out and exercise some of the demons, it may come in this particular spot. Your analysis talking about Peter Mrazek, who is expected to start for the Blackhawks, he's actually been a quiet revelation. Now, I know the wins haven't been there. You have to go back to February 25th. His start against the San Jose Sharks to find his last victory, but that's not all on him. In his last 6 starts and 7 appearances, he's given up a grand total of 14 goals. I mean, a save percentage of .925 and a goals against average, better than you'd expect for a Blackhawks team that's really been struggling. So it's over or pass here for sure, underdog or pass in my opinion. And you wonder if this is where some of that regression starts to show up for the Blues, knowing that the Blackhawks beat them in their most recent meeting and did so as an underdog north of $2 in a game that indeed went over the total, like each of the last 3 matchups have done between these familiar divisional foes.
Yeah, the Blackhawks hoping to take advantage of some home cooking here in this spot at the United Center. We'll see how that one plays out. Last but not least, and I'm doing my same game parlay on this game, the LA Kings taking on the Edmonton Oilers. I know we talked about the Oilers and the Kings in our show on Tuesday, but now these two teams going head-to-head, and this could be a potential playoff round. The Kings are second in the division right now. They dropped their last game to the Flames, which was their first loss in regulation in 12 games, which is pretty crazy. They were 10-0-2 in the games before then, and the Oilers are right behind them. They have 95 points on the season. They're on a 2-game winning streak. They're coming off of scoring 7 goals against Vegas, and let me just say, Todd, you were right. I had Vegas money line. The Oilers are on the second half of back-to-back. You, my friend, we're very correct on that one, but both teams have been on fire. I mean, Absolutely on fire. I think LA right now, like for the season, they're averaging around 3.4 goals per game. But over the last 10 games or so, they're averaging 4.3 goals per game. And the same with the Oilers. They're averaging just under 4 goals on the season. But over the last 10, 12 games, they're averaging over 4.5 goals per game. Do you feel like we're going to see a lot of goals being scored in this one? Because I really like the over.
You know, not a lot of margin of error in the Pacific Division. Yeah. When we look at the way the Golden Knights have played, the Edmonton Oilers and the Kings, all three teams vying for that top spot. And as you mentioned, jockeying for playoff position in what could very well be a playoff preview that we'll see tonight. This Edmonton Oilers team has been fascinating to watch because for so many years, you look at that roster and went, okay, they'll go as far as Connor McDavid can take them. And while that still obviously is very relevant, this group goes three lines deep, and they have a ton of firepower coming at you from a variety of different angles. You know, whether it's Connor McDavid on that top unit or Jay Woodcroft looking to pair him up with Leon Draisaitl, not just on the power play, but also at 5-on-5. Ryan Nugent-Hopkins putting together arguably one of the quietest 100-point seasons we've seen. Evander Kane healthy. You're getting guys like Kyler Yamamoto and Warren Fogle to chip in. So this Edmonton Oilers team is as electric as they get. And when you look at their remaining schedule, a home and home essentially with the Kings, a grand total of 4 games against the Sharks and Ducks, they very well could have something to say about who wins the division. And at a price right around plus 430, you can make a lot worse bets than backing the Oilers in that department. But it's got to start tonight against the Kings team, who you highlighted being white hot, at least up until they ran into Jacob Markstrom, who turned aside 32 shots in that victory the other night. Mm. But what's interesting about that game, Lauren, the Flames had not one, not two, but 3 goals called back. So things could have been a little bit worse on the score sheet for the LA Kings. I think if LA is going to have success in this kind of hostile environment, they need to focus on their back end out and try and lock things down defensively, limit scoring chances for the Edmonton Oilers, because even as well as the Kings have performed going forward, I mean, this is a team that's going to feel much more comfortable in a 3-2 type hockey game. So we'll see how all of that unfolds tonight.
Totally. You talk about the defensive game. The Oilers right now, bottom 11, they're allowing 3.33 goals per game. The Kings, middle of the pack, they allow about 3.18 goals per game. But that's the good thing about both of these teams is they've been winning a lot of games because they score a heck of a lot of goals. But let's talk about the defensive side between the pipes. Jonas Korpisalo, he's been pretty good, 4-1-0 in his last 5. He only allowed 9 total goals. And Stuart Skinner on the other side, 5-0-0 in his last 5. He's allowed 16 total goals in those games. Who has the edge between the pipes on the defensive side today between those two teams?
I'm actually going to call it a wash. I really like what I've seen from Jonas Korpisalo since the Kings acquired him from the Columbus Blue Jackets. You mentioned some of those numbers, a goals against average under 2 since he took over. And I think he could see his streak of allowing 2 goals or fewer come to an end tonight against this Oilers attack. But as far as the save percentage is concerned, he's answered the bell, and I think there are a lot of questions in LA in terms of who will be their game one starter. But for me, when I look at the current form, the eye test, some of the underlying numbers, I think it has to be Korpisalo. Credit to Phoenix Copley. He stabilized the position when they weren't getting goaltending from Cal Peterson or Jonathan Quick. But the win-loss record doesn't mesh with what you've seen from a save percentage standpoint and goal save above expected. So for me, Korpisalo has to be the guy in some of these big games down the stretch. And that's probably why we'll see him tonight. Stuart Skinner on the other side, I know people look at the goals against number and they get a little bit concerned. But look, the Oilers are involved in a ton of high event hockey. And the reality of it is he's asked to do a lot when the team hangs him out to dry. But we've seen Edmonton in some of these playoff type atmospheres, in these tight checking games and matchups against, say, the Dallas Stars, or even as recent as Saturday night against the Vegas Golden Knights, where it was a 3-3 game headed to overtime. So for me, I think we could get better goaltending performances than a lot of the numbers suggest. And it's part of the reason that you've seen a little bit of under money come in the betting market early today when that was a 7 flat. And you're now seeing the number trend towards a juice 6.5 at FanDuel.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see how this game plays out. It makes me a little nervous when I talk about my same game parlay because last game I hit 2 of the 3 legs, obviously, but the only leg I didn't hit, you were right about, the Oilers money line. So today I'm going back to the well and I'm switching it up for my same game parlay with FanDuel. I have the Oilers money line. I have over 6.5 and a goal scored in the first 10 minutes. I am not going against the Oilers this time. They are 7-0-1 since their last loss in regulation. They're 11-3-1 in their last 15 games. Like we said, it's going to be a total goal fest here. Both teams averaging over 4.3 goals in their last 10 to 12 games that they've played. And they're going to want to get it done early and get it done often. I feel like there's a goal that's going to be scored in the first 10 minutes of the first period. So we'll see how it goes. The last two, I hit two of the three legs. But Todd, like you said, if you hit two of the three legs in every parlay, you're still not winning the parlay. So you hate to see it.
Yeah, really, unfortunately, that's the case. And that's the allure of the single game parlay, Lauren. And, you know, I hate when I'm right at your expense. The one leg that I'm concerned about tonight, not to try and be Debbie Downer here, I'm worried about that total, but we'll see what we have. Never anything wrong with trying to bet Oilers games over, especially at a better number at 6.5. You can go over 6.5. I can go under 7. Maybe you win and I push on that thing.
Yeah. Do you think, from Glenn Hoffman, the Oilers goaltending will be their Achilles heel again? Are they in better shape than they were last year? Hey, Glenn, what's going on?
Glenn, I do think they're in better shape, but there is no doubt if there is one weakness on this roster, it's Stuart Skinner, most likely, his ability to steal games when you're talking about a lot of those 2-1, 3-2 type playoff games. Edmonton brought in Jack Campbell thinking that he was going to be the guy to stabilize the position. Unfortunately, Campbell hasn't been that guy. And Stuart Skinner is going to be called on, because when I look at the landscape of the Western Conference right now, the way these teams are all currently constructed, I have Edmonton as my top power rated team out there. But you know what? Games aren't played on spreadsheets, and if you can't keep pucks out of your own net, that could be a big problem. But I do think this is an Oilers decor that's a little better built to give Skinner some of that support that he needs. When you look at a player like Matthias Ekholm, who they picked up from Nashville, I think that's the guy that's going to make all the difference if Edmonton's going to make a deep run, not only to get to the Western Conference Finals, but maybe have a chance to play for the Stanley Cup this year. So if Skinner is better than what they got a season ago, I think Edmonton will be just fine in terms of their postseason prospects.
Yeah, it's going to be fun to watch to see how it plays out in the future. One more question from L.A. Jackie. Who will get the last wild card spot in the West? I don't know if you agree with me, Todd. I still think it's going to be the Winnipeg Jets that hold on to that spot. Connor Hellebuyck has been amazing on the season. I feel like whichever team has a good goaltender, they can kind of ride that. The Preds have more of an uphill climb at that point. I think it's going to be the Jets that hold on, but interested to see what you think on which team in the West will get the last wild card spot before the postseason.
I know my shirt says one thing, Lauren, but come on. We've talked about the Western Conference a ton. You know who my affinity is for at the bottom of that Western Conference. And I can't abandon them in their time of need. I'm going to take the Calgary Flames. And honestly, I think if you're looking for a little bit of a flyer as far as the Western Conference futures are concerned, this is a Calgary team, 30-1, 40-1. If they get in, nobody's going to want to see them. Let's hope, if you're a Calgary fan, that what we saw from Jacob Markstrom the other night against the Kings is a sign of things to come. Naz Kadri, a couple of goals. Maybe the Flames can be that Cinderella story after being perennial underachievers. We know change is coming in the Canadian Rockies this offseason, but the perfect salve for a wound that has been the regular season thus far would be a potential postseason run. So Calgary, my pick to get in.
He's
with that 8-spot
all
hold.
All in on the Flames, Todd Furman. We'll see what happens down the next week and a half for the final few games of the regular season here in the NHL. Don't miss us too much this weekend. We'll be back with you every single Tuesday and Thursday for NHL Puckline. Until then, have a great weekend. Enjoy opening day. Enjoy March Madness. We'll see you guys on Tuesday. Peace.